Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, wherever you are in the world. Welcome to the Water Pavilion at COP26. My name is Henk Ovink, Special Envoy for International Water Affairs, and moderating a session now on a new approach for hydroclimatic risk management. That is something we need. It is a partnership between the World Bank on one and Deltares, the Research and Knowledge Institute from the Netherlands on subsoil and water. They work together on an EPIC response, a governance for flood and drought risk management. EPIC is the acronym for enabling environment of policies, laws, strategic plans and information. P, the planning at all levels to prioritize risk mitigation. I, investing in healthy watersheds and water resource infrastructure. And C, controlling the use of water and land to reduce exposures and vulnerabilities and respond better to extreme events. The flagship report, An EPIC Response, was launched in June 2021. It provides a new perspective on hydroclimatic risks by looking at floods and droughts through the same lens. So it combines floods and droughts perspective on risks, identifying the roles of different government agencies managing these risks, and highlights where and how these agencies need to collaborate. Cutting across a collaborative approach, bringing together floods and droughts to ensure that governance is not in the way to the response, but becomes an enabler. Main concepts of the EPIC response framework here in the session will be Greg Browder from the World Bank. Greg is a lead water resource management specialist at the World Bank. And during the preparation of the report, he served as the global lead for water and resiliency. Greg has over 20 years of experience at the World Bank and been involved in any large scale project in Asia, Latin America and across. He's published numerous studies on water resource management and urban water supply and sanitation, and holds a PhD in environmental engineering from Stanford. Greg, it's amazing to see you and to have you with us. I'll quickly introduce the other speakers, but I will go longer in detail. We also have Eelco van Beek from Deltares and Ana Nunez Sanchez, but I will introduce who you are later, okay? Greg, floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Am I audible to the participants? Good, thank you. Thank you for that kind introduction, Henk, and it's my great pleasure to be with you today at the COP virtually. I'm actually at a remote location in India, and unfortunately my Wi-Fi is not very good. One of the challenges of doing virtual sessions in this age of COVID. But don't fear, I have pre-recorded my presentation because I was afraid I'd run into these technical difficulties. So without further ado, Erica, if you could play the presentation. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Greg Browder, and I am a lead water resources specialist at the World Bank. Today, it is my pleasure to introduce the EPIC Response Report, Innovative Governance for Flood and Drought Risk Management. The report was launched in June 2021 and is a collaborative effort between Deltares and the World Bank. The report is based upon 4 case studies and an extensive literature review. It presents the most comprehensive compendium of flood and drought policies and programs that exist in literature. The report helps to bring together the flood and the drought communities using the lens of hydroclimatic risk management, which I will explain later. It focuses on the role of national government agencies, which are critical to addressing flood and drought risk management. And these agencies are also typically the direct counterparts of the World Bank. Now, the report is over 200 pages long, and I don't have time to go over all the details. So let me present the main message now. What's needed is a joined up government effort leading a whole of society approach. What does this mean? A joined up government effort means there are many different agencies involved in flood and drought risk management. For example, HydroMet, disaster management, water resources. These agencies must work together collaboratively and synergistically so that the government has a joined up effort. The government in turn cannot do it by itself. It must bring together all of society. It must bring together civil society, the private sector, households, and very important, marginalized and disadvantaged communities. Now, this is not easy. This is why we call it an epic response. But surely it's necessary, as this is one of the great challenges of our time in this era of climate change. Now, the term hydroclimatic risk management may not be familiar to all of you. Essentially, what it means is looking at both climate and hydrology, which help frame our flood and drought management challenges. And honestly, we like to use the term because we get tired of constantly saying floods and droughts. There are many different hydroclimatic zones around the world. For example, tropical monsoon climates, hot deserts, the humid tropics, the humid subtropics, Mediterranean regions. Each of these climate zones have their own unique flood and drought challenges. But the report utilizes general principles that really can apply to any of these different regions. One of the most important principles is that hydroclimatic hazards don't have to become disasters if we proactively manage these risks. Now, many countries are not doing a very good job of this. As noted by the previous speakers, the economic and social cost of hydroclimatic extremes are really staggering. But what this report does is it provides a framework, what we call the EPIC response framework, to comprehensively and systematically cover all the different dimensions that are necessary to really confront these challenges. So as I mentioned before, there are many different agencies working on hydroclimatic risk management. The report goes over the mandates of these different agencies in detail and also identifies ways where they can collaborate. We looked at HydroMet agencies, water resource agencies, natural resource management agencies, agricultural agencies, and of course, disaster risk management agencies. And the key message here is that each of these agencies have to fulfill their specific mandates and do so effectively, but they need to go beyond this. They need to collaborate for a joined up government effort to achieve an epic response. So if we just describe the agency mandates, the report would be pretty boring and frankly not that useful. So what we did is we put on our thinking caps and we developed this EPIC response framework. It consists of 12 different program areas. These program areas interact synergistically and in complex ways, but generally in a downward cascading manner to ultimately influence what are the final economic, social, and environmental impacts of extreme hydroclimatic events. Now, I'll walk you through each of these program areas one by one. Please stay with me. I think it's an interesting stroll. At the top, we have the enabling program areas, headed by the national legal system. This national legal framework authorizes the programs, assigns the implementing agencies, and very importantly, funds these programs. These agencies, in turn, need to have their own programs for facilitating a whole of society approach. They need to tap into and bring along the private sector, local government, civil society, the scientific community, and most importantly, marginalized communities who often do not fully benefit from formal programs. Hydrological and meteorological services are indispensable for almost every program in the framework, and thus they form part of the enabling environment. Now, if we want to take a proactive approach, almost by definition, we need to have planning processes for flood and drought risk mitigation, as well as contingency planning. And the report looks in detail at many different types of planning processes, which are shown here in this graphic. I'd like to highlight two main points. First, flood and drought planning is almost always embedded in larger planning processes. Let me give you two examples. Flood and drought planning at the river basin needs to take place within a broader river basin planning process that's done with an integrated perspective and takes into account the many different issues of integrated water management at the basin level. For urban flood management planning, this is almost always part of a broader urban development planning process. The second major concept or principle we identify is that this planning needs to take place within a nested geographical context. For example, if you're a water utility or an irrigation service provider, and you're developing your flood mitigation and contingency planning, you have to take the river basin context into account, and your plan should mesh with the broader river basin management plan. Planning also helps to inform investment programs for healthy watersheds and water resources infrastructure. Healthy watersheds consist of forests, floodplains, wetlands, and coastal barriers that provide essential ecosystem services. We often refer to these as green infrastructure. Water resources infrastructure are generally man-made assets, such as dams or river embankments or regional water conveyance systems. We often refer to this as gray infrastructure. Now, integrating green and gray infrastructure really is the next generation of infrastructure. And by the way, that was the title of the last report that I co-authored. Probably the best way to manage our flood and drought risks is to control the way that we use water and land. For example, for drought mitigation, having a dynamic water allocation system is indispensable for transferring water from lower value uses to higher value uses during droughts and water shortages. It's also necessary to have a long-term continuous process of water allocation moving towards higher value uses. During droughts, the strategic use of groundwater is absolutely essential, as groundwater is oftentimes our only resource available during extreme droughts. For floods, by far, the best tool that we have in our toolbox is floodplain management. This is really the key to effective flood risk management. Now, when an extreme event hits, whether it's a flood or a drought, and you know, it always seems to strike when we're on vacation, right? We need to have programs in place so we can monitor, respond, and recover from these extreme events. Very importantly, we need to learn from each experience so that we can systematically improve our hydroclimatic risk management system, but also we can build back better after each disaster. Finally, disaster risk financing is very important for funding these response and recovery efforts. This includes developing a multi-layered disaster risk financing strategy that is tailored to the country's unique risk profile. To summarize, the report developed the EPIC response framework. It consists of 12 different program areas that interact in a synergistic and complex manner, but generally in a downward cascading fashion that is explained in detail in the report, ultimately determining the final economic, social, and environmental impacts of an extreme event. Now, we are not naive. We know that developing an EPIC response is an evolutionary and a continuous process, particularly in this era of climate change. And it depends very much on a country's level of economic development, as well as its quality of governance. To address this issue, the report develops generic development tables, which are shown at the top of this slide. Recall that we have 12 different program areas. Within these 12 different program areas, the report has another 40 specific programs related to floods and droughts that are described. Each of these program areas has its own program-specific development table. This will allow a country to examine each program, compare it to the development table, and see where they are in this evolutionary process. Now, if you remember from the beginning of the presentation, which actually right now might seem a long time ago, I stressed that we need to have a systemic systems perspective on this and ensure a joined-up government response. Thus, one of the key recommendations of the report is to have periodic, interlocking national strategic plans for water resources, disaster management, drought, and climate adaptation. Now, I imagine that some of you are rolling your eyes, saying, oh no, recommending another planning process, but this is really important. As General Dwight D. Eisenhower, Supreme Allied Commander during World War II, used to say, planning is a substitution of error for chaos. If we don't have these national strategic plans, we really will be in a state of chaos, and we cannot develop our hydroclimatic risk management systems properly. So I hope you enjoyed this whirlwind tour of the EPIC response report. I encourage you to go on the web and download the various products that are available. We have a main report, which is an interactive document, an executive summary, and a brochure which highlights the main principles of an EPIC response. Thank you for your attention today. Goodbye.
Thank you, Greg. Amazing presentation, touching upon almost every aspect on preparedness and response, combining also from this systems approach that you alluded on, the critical importance of that. A systems approach on the substance of risks and opportunities, leading to a systems approach in governance from collaboration to inclusion. So I think what you also rightly say is that the complexity of the issue out there with climate, with development and humanitarian issues, cannot be addressed by single-focused solutions, let alone single-focused approaches. Complexity needs to be addressed with these wicked problems need to be addressed through a complex lens. Only by understanding that complexity are we able to get through. Plan or fail is like the smallest summary of what you said. Thanks very much for leading us through. The other thing you also say, perhaps before I go to our next speaker, is don't be afraid of this complexity. It is complex, but not facing that complexity is worse. That will lead, as we see around the world, to disaster and despair. If you embrace that complexity as an asset, then you see a path towards sustainability, resiliency, and equity. Thanks very much, Greg. Second speaker, Eelco, is an eminence in the field of Eelco van Beek, eminence in the field of water resources management and water security. During the over 40 years of his professional career, And I can assure you that seems old, but ILCO is very young at heart. Professor Van Beek has been actively involved in many water resource development projects, ranging from projects with an emphasis on long-term planning to real-time operation. From projects aimed at pre-feasibility studies to full-scale river basins plans, and from integrated studies to single-aspect studies. Professor Van Beek teaches at the Delft University of Technology and the University of Twente, as well as the IHG Delft Institute. ILCO, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Henk. Can you see my screen now?
Yes.
Yes? Okay. What just Greg mentioned, the EPIC response framework tells us how we should organize the governance of flood and drought risk management. And in preparing this EPIC framework, we looked at four cases. We looked at how it is done in California. We looked how it is done in the Philippines and in Tanzania and also in the Netherlands. And this presentation is about the Netherlands case. How does the hydroclimatic risk management system in the Netherlands look like? And as such, it is more or less a real life example of the EPIC response framework. Does it work? So you see here the cover of the report that we have published. And you see clearly pictures that is not the Netherlands, but you can replace that. July 2021, flooding in the Netherlands. Summer 2018, dry conditions. And what the use of a floating house if there is no water? And those events have been the trigger, the main trigger for evolution of water governance in the Netherlands. And the major, I just mentioned a few, the 1953 storm surge, sea flooding, river flooding 1997, major threat, drought risk in a few years. But then also climate change. Climate change, we have to prepare ourselves for more of this kind of events. And that's why the Netherlands has started this Delta program. And important in the Delta program is that it's an integrated approach of floods and droughts, just what also the EPIC framework mentions. Now, and in this Delta program, there is associated a major governance changes, laws, institutions, and also the funding, how you finance this. But before I go into detail, just the Netherlands, for the ones that don't know it, 55% is a flood risk area, the dark blue area, 29% is below average sea level, 26% is floodplains, 10 million people, and 2,000 billion invested capital, coastline, 3,500 kilometer flood events, locks, sluices, pumping stations to protect our country against flooding, but also an extensive system of canals and pumps to drain the water, but at the same time to supply water to areas during dry periods. So droughts can happen in the whole country, but the most serious in part that is light blue here, or gray. So the Netherlands a little bit, or you have floods in the dark blue, or you have droughts in the gray area. But again, there is also a drought in the blue area, if that cases. Now, how do we deal with it? Two governance bodies, the main ones, Rijkswaterstaat and the water boards, and they are dealing with floods and drought, but also with water quality. But that's not what we're dealing with now. So Rijkswaterstaat at the national level, the water board at the regional level. And that is being done in our normal system of central government, provinces and municipalities, and Rijkswaterstaat and the water boards together, they take care of our water resources management. Rijkswaterstaat at the national level, although they have 8 regions in which they are organized, and the water boards, 21 water boards. And you see at the municipal level, but you see that the water boards cover many municipalities, and not only. This is water resources management. But then you have flood and drought risk, the disaster risk management, and that is organized differently in the Netherlands. That is done at the municipality level, but organized in so-called safety regions. And those safety regions are addressing all kinds of disasters. And although not in word and disaster, but also this safety region, they address the COVID epidemic at this moment. So that is how we deal with the disaster risk management. And they have to come together, and I will explain that. Now I explain all those steps that Greg just presented, the EP, IC, and respond. So before I do that, I recall this slide that Greg also presented. And the approach that we have in the Netherlands is also an evolutionary process. It has been triggered by events and dependent on economic development and the quality of governance situation. We have developed it, just the words of Greg. We moved from a nation state to an effective state through those processes. And it started long time ago. The first water boards were already nearly 900 years ago. So it is a continuous process in which periodically you formulate national plans, the disaster risk management, drought management, climate adaptation, and continuously improve your program performance through monitoring, evaluation, and adjustment. So what I'm presenting is the result of that. So first, the enabling part, the national frameworks, the three water, or the two water agencies as mentioned, the water boards, very old, Rijkswater is not that young, but also supporting by other agencies, like, for example, a very strong hydromet service. The legal basis, the 2009 Water Act, which compiled at that time previous key water acts on water management, on drinking water, on flood defense, on groundwater, into one unified legal framework. This integration is an important part. And that water law specifies also, for example, the flood safety standards. The 2009 Water Act had also a structured linkage with the Spatial Planning Act. It's very important for good water management. And this integration is continuing. There are now plans to incorporate this 2009 Water Act into a new Environmental Act, which mainstream water, environment, and agriculture under a unified land management process. So even more integration. But besides this specific Water Act, we have the Delta Act, and that is addressing the threat of climate change. We have a National Delta Program that is looking at floods and droughts with a Delta Commissioner, somebody at the level of a minister that is overseeing the implementation, the preparation of the country to be prepared for climate change. And they have money to spend. Also, the point that Greg mentioned, important, the whole of society approach, that's more or less embedded in our system. The water boards, democratic organizations, they are interest-based. That is where you bring in the interest together. But also the way the Netherlands in general is quite consensus-oriented. And we call that the polder approach. And the fact that it is called a polder approach, that shows that that is how we started to get consensus. We had to agree to keep our feet dry and by having those polders. So that are the enabling conditions. A little bit specific about the strategic planning, three levels, national, regional, and local level. Two types of plans, strategic plans and management plans, and that are more operational plans. And they are then at that three levels, the national level, provincial level, the strategic plans and the operation plans. We have it at the national level, the regional level, the water board plans, but also we still have at the municipal level, the sewage plans. And they are very much aligned with spatial planning, the national spatial planning, but also the provincial and the municipal spatial planning. And in addition, We have this Delta program that fills it in with yearly programs to address the safety, the freshwater supply and spatial adaptation. Something I'm not mentioning, but is important also, we are working within the European Framework Directive and Flood Directive. So that is a leading point in our planning exercise. So this is the strategic planning. Now we talk about this mitigation and contingency planning, planning for disaster risk management. That is a joint responsibility of the water resource management agencies and the disaster risk management, the safety regions. For both floods and droughts, they prepared contingency plans. They prepared crisis manuals, roadmaps, and a communication strategy. And it's important to know, to realize that the ultimate responsibility for disaster risk management is with the Ministry of Security and Justice, and not with the Ministry of Water Resources and Infrastructure. And how do you deal with those responsibilities? And I explain that later. The next one is invest, healthy watershed, water resources, infrastructure. Now, we have historically been very much infrastructure based. We know how to build dikes, the delta works, the pole, the pumps, etc. But what we see nowadays, more and more attention is being based, given to nature-based solutions. That's what also Greg mentioned. The Room for the River program that we have is clearly nature-based. The scent engine, the National Beach Nourishment, the water conservation. And that shows a little bit this picture, that also showing that, that good flood management can prevent drought conditions. If you have this flood and you can have retention at the up part, you store it before you drain it. And the fact that we do it this way now, in comparison with our previous policy, is to get rid of the water as soon as possible, helps us also to improve the drought situation. And that we even have to do more than we do now. So number four, the control. Control, we have the ISA lake. If you talk about water allocation, we have an ISA lake, and we can use that to store water. And then the level control of the ISA lake is imbalancing between the storage. You like to have a high level as possible, and flood control, where you want to have it as low as possible to be able to store it. So even if it is a very narrow margin in which you can control the water level at the ice lake, it is the same as you do in a multi-purpose reservoir. Under normal conditions, by the way, there is abundance of water in the Netherlands. So the Netherlands is also one of the few countries in the world where we don't have water rights. Of course, we have permits and that kind of, but no explicit water rights. But even without water rights, in periods of droughts, the contingency plans has to be followed. There has been a priority for high level use, explicitly mentioned. So the, if there is a drought, the water allocation takes place. Floodplain management, also mentioned by Greg as an important element, Room for the River project that focus the management of the floodplains on nature and recreation. And so to enable the discharge of the water if needed, but also at the same time to have more nature available. And of course, there are rules in if there are high river discharges, particularly conditions are imposed on shipping and access to the floodplains. But then finally, the last one, the response. So how do we respond to floods and droughts? And we try to avoid them, but we get them. And so there is a central organization, the Netherlands Water Management Center, which is part of Rijkswaterstaat, actually cooperating with all other stakeholders, that deals with floods and droughts, and supported by hydrometric specialized agencies. Now, what is specific? They work with a four-coloring coding system, and that indicates the level of severity of the flood and drought event. And to the right, you see for drought, how it is defined. The zero, the green one, is normal management. Yellow, there is a first sign of water shortage coming up, maybe. Once in 1 and 2 years, it is happening. Once in 5 years, we see an orange situation where and actually water shortage starts to happen. And the red one, number three, is that we really have a crisis once in 10, 20 years in which there is socioeconomic impacts. And depending on that color code, the level of severity, responsible agencies will be activated, being in place. And including the upscaling at a certain moment from water source management to disaster risk management, shifting to the safety organization. Now, how to upscale? A clear criteria has been set for drought and for flood. Green, normal conditions, normal management. But for drought, we look at the discharges of our main rivers. We look at the precipitation deficit. We look at salinity situation. And depending on it, first measures are being taken. If you go to the orange level two, some first measures are being implemented and so on. With flood, it is the same. We look at the situation and we decide what to do. And at the first level, the standard measures at the yellow level, but then large scale measures and at the highest level, the real impacts are felt and measures are taken. And that is being translated into the level of attention for the situation. And now it is turned around. Bottom is green, the national water management. If it is getting yellow, it's going to the regional level, regional coordination. If it is getting worse, it's going to the departmental level. And at the highest red level, we see the ministries coming in. And actually, at that moment, even the prime minister will chair the situation. And all those three levels, the yellow, orange and red, there is this involvement of the stakeholders and also the relationship with the media. So, and how do you upscale them? And that's more or less my last slide before the conclusions, is that, yeah, we follow the color coding. And I'm not going to explain all this abbreviation of the organization, but you will see that you have more or less the water resource management pillar and the disaster risk management pillar. It starts going up in the water resource management pillar, but from the start there is a linkage with the safety regions. It's going to the regional level, it's going to the ministerial level, but at a certain moment it goes to the red part where disaster risk management works. But in all those stages, those agencies have to work closer together, involving the stakeholders. Now, this is how it works. If you look at it, and that's how I presented this, is our system aligns very well with the EPIC response framework. And we realize that also in our situation, what I mentioned is this system has been developed as an evolutionary process, and it still goes on. And we also are convinced that if you're looking at our system, that all those elements that are mentioned by Greg needs to be in place and actually are in place and are quite effective, I think, in the Netherlands. But it should address the specific local conditions. And so the historic situation, physical development level, that was mentioned. And that means also that what I just presented, the Netherlands system, is not a blueprint for other countries. Absolutely not. I think that that's why you have to look at the EPIC response framework, because that helps the best approach for a specific country. And of course, you can use such examples and being illustrated by the Netherlands case. But if you do that, do it step by step as an evolutionary process. And with that, I conclude my presentation. Back to you, Henk.
Thank you, Eelco. Thank you for taking us through not only ages of water management and disaster risk management in the Netherlands, but also highlighting how that complexity of organization actually is a guarantee for success. As long as that transparency is there and that coordination across is clear and that everybody knows what to do, there is a level of certainty in your presentation that in reality also is backed with a redundancy in governance. A Delta program in itself is already outside of the institutional system to ensure that you have redundancy also in your governance. So thanks for making that pretty clear. You were also very long in time. So now we have to get to the end quite quickly. And the last presentation, Ana Núñez Sánchez, you come to the water resource management from an institutional law and policy perspective. 15 years of experience in water resource management. You worked the design and implementation of water-related projects in Latin America, the Middle East, and Southeast Asia. Ana is also co-author of the EPIC Response Report, and you will introduce an effort to develop the EPIC Response Assessment methodology. Ana, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Henk, and thank you all for being here this evening. So as Henk and Greg mentioned, the World Bank and Deltares partner for over 2 years to develop the Global Flagship Report and EPIC Response, which focuses on innovative governance for flood and drought risk management. So the report launched in June last year, and since then, we have been very fortunate to present it widely. And the overwhelming feedback that we have received from practitioners and knowledge partners during the dissemination phase is that we need to operationalize the useful concepts that are included in the EPIC response framework and help countries apply them and strengthen their flood and drought risk management systems. So in response to that feedback, the same team that brought you the EPIC response framework is getting together again to develop an EPIC response assessment methodology. So the EPIC response assessment methodology aims at supporting practitioners and countries to assess the status of the hydroclimatic risk management system and identify areas where programs and the collaboration between them should be strengthened. We hope that the assessment methodology will ultimately constitute a decision support system that will inform the continuous evolution of flood and drought risk management systems. So we're just starting right now, and we hope to have a first prototype of the tool and a couple of pilot applications in the second half of next year. But let me give you a sneak peek of the concept of the tool. Erika, can you go back a couple of slides to the EPIC response? Thank you, that's it. So Greg and Elko presented this EPIC response framework and these 12 different program areas that form the EPIC response framework. Well, actually those 12 program areas consist of 40 specific programs that are related to flood and drought management. Next, Erika, please. So this is the entire list of the programs that we looked at. So the report that we put together describes the key elements of an effective program. It describes the important functions that responsible sector agencies should undertake to ensure an effective program. And it provides this generic program evolution table that Greg and Elko alluded to, recognizing, of course, that a program development is an evolutionary process. Next. So we're hoping that the EPIC response assessment methodology will build from these tables and will help practitioners to evaluate the development status of the programs that form the EPIC response framework. And will also help deliver useful references and examples and good practices and guidelines that are related to program development. Next. Also, Greg mentioned during this presentation that we have all these agencies that have a role in flood and drought risk management and they need to fulfill their mandate, but unfortunately, this is not enough and they need to go over the mandate to collaborate in a joint up government response. Well, the programs that these agencies also implement interact in complex and synergistic ways. And ultimately, the way that these programs work together determine the ultimate environmental, social, and economic impacts of any hydroclimatic hazard. So we're hoping that the EPIC response assessment methodology will build from these key linkages that are described in the report and will help practitioners to evaluate the level of development in the collaboration between these programs. And we'll couple this evaluation with key conceptual elements like the background, the challenge, and the opportunities in the continuous evolution of hydroclimatic risk management systems. We're hoping also to pilot the methodology in two cases, and we're considering right now the state of Assam in India and also the Gambia. So listen, the message that we're hearing throughout this COP from Greta Thunberg to Prime Minister Rutte from the Netherlands to President Obama is that we need to move from the blah, blah realm to action. And I could not be prouder to be here today offering a concrete way for governments to channel this energy and spur a whole of society approach to resilience. So we hope that the EPIC response assessment methodology and the framework will enable constructive and action-oriented policy discussion and will support government agencies to develop a common understanding of their role, the status of the programs, and a way forward in the process of strengthening hydroclimatic risk management systems. And ultimately, what we really want is that for this framework and this methodology to help countries to deliver better resilience services to communities, even those that are underserved, and not only reduce the toll for flood and drought disasters, but also to generate opportunity and to create a more resilient and a more prosperous planet. So let's get to work. Hank, back over to you. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Anna. And thank you also still for being very swift and clear. But I do have a question to you. You went fastest through your presentation. The EPIC response framework is, you know, it's been a collaboration, amazing collaboration between Deltares and the World Bank. But if we look around the world when we think about resiliency and adaptation, we also always say every place, every culture, every political system, every governance is different. At the same time, you are a true believer through the practice of this EPIC response framework that you provide a tailored approach with this one framework. So there, it's like a little bit of magic in that. Can you expand a bit on why with this framework you have the capacity to tailor it to almost every system, every condition, every culture to that matter, and why that is also so important?
Well, thank you very much, Hank. First of all, we're just looking at the combination of management of floods and droughts. And we believe that no matter really in which climatic zone a particular country finds itself at, all countries need to manage this unique set of floods and drought challenges. And these challenges are, of course, growing with climate change. So we believe that these understanding of hydroclimatic risk management apply to all countries. And we also have been, we're looking at agencies and we're looking at the mandate of particular agencies, and these agencies and these programs might vary in terms of how they're called or where they're located, but the functions are fundamentally the same. There is always a water agency or disaster risk management agency, an agriculture agency, a natural resources or environmental agency, a hydromet agency. All these mandates are common. And so we find that the principles of the EPIC response framework actually apply to those. Yeah, and then at the same time, as we're talking about all these 40 programs are pretty ubiquitous in all these countries. We're also trying to, of course, we cannot go to a great level of detail. So every time that we are presenting a program, we're also introducing these guidance and these best practices to help practitioners to dig deeper in the nature of these programs if they wish so. So I hope I answered your question, Hank.
Fantastic, Anna. Yeah, you did. And it also gives hope in a conference like COP that no matter how dire your situation, the challenging some circumstances or the governance or culture you have in place, there's an opportunity to move forward in this combination of disaster risk management and integrated water resource management. Thank you. World Bank and Deltares compliment and celebration to having the operationalization of the concept of such a framework into a tool helps putting in practice innovative governance approaches. At a time when the world is overwhelmingly turning to governments to do more to be ready and respond to the impacts of climate crisis. I have to close this because we ran already 6 minutes over time. The framework presented is an innovative perspective to the combined management of floods and drought, combining those two aspects. The content of the report is both groundbreaking as detailed, presenting the most extensive compendium of flood and drought policies and programs that currently exist in literature. Now it's time to put it into practice. Action now. As many of our leaders, but I think most importantly, many of the people around the world that are vulnerable to the impacts of climate change demand. It is action now. This report presents them an opportunity to act, scale and replicate those initiatives and embed them in governance and structures that are really able to help, that focus on an enabling environment across society that is not only an institutional capacity, but it is also community and cultural capacity. Reducing risks and creating opportunities. And with that, combine the aspects of climate mitigation and adaptation. Thank you so much for all your presentations. Thanks Greg, Ilko and Anna for your amazing work. And thanks the audience and the world who was watching and listening for being with us. Really look forward to our next event. Thanks very much. Wish you a great day.